You know, the idea of dream analysis, I suppose, is one of Freud's, perhaps Freud's major contribution to modern Western thought. The idea was there was something to dreams. And I suppose what Freud did is said, hey, look, isn't it strange? We have this whole other form of thought that we engage in at night, and it speaks in a language that we don't really understand. And so what the hell is that? And you can say, and many modern people do, dreams are of no significance, or even that they're random processes, which is an absurd proposition, obviously, because they're obviously not random. So Freud's idea was that there was something in dreams that was informative. So that's his, now he had a method for extracting out from the dream what the dream purported to represent. And he outlined that in great detail in The Interpretation of Dreams. And if you want to read one book by Freud, I would highly recommend that one. It's a very long book and it's very detailed, but Freud does an extraordinarily comprehensive analysis of the way that dreams work. Now he made because he had brought a theoretical framework to bear, even on his investigation into dream structure, he concluded that dreams were essentially wish fulfillments. And that's where Jung and Freud disagreed. He also believed that the primary motivating factor of human beings was sexual. And now that's a tougher one to toss aside, because even if you're a Darwinian rather than a Freudian, you're going to obviously support the proposition that sexual motivation among any living creature is going to be one of the highest order motivations, because otherwise creatures don't reproduce and prevail over the long run. So the question is that the ultimate source of motivation? And in some sense, the answer to that has to be yes. Well, Freud wanted to make that in some ways the sole source of motivation. And I'm oversimplifying, and I hate to do that in relationship to Freud, because he was not a simple-minded character. Jung had a dream once, if I remember correctly, that Freud and Jung were excavating a basement. And so Freud had outlined, Freud had already discovered the basement, let's say, so that would be the unconscious structure of the psyche. And Jung broke through into another basement that was a multi-chambered place, so many, many, many rooms. And I suppose what drove Jung and Freud apart was Jung's proposition that there was a hell of a lot more going on down there than had already met the eye. And they broke on the idea that the sexual impulse was primary. Roughly speaking, they broke when Jung wrote a book called Symbols of Transformation, which is actually, there's three books that I know of that are sort of like maps of meaning. One is Symbols of Transformation. One is a book by Eric Neumann called The Origins and History of Consciousness. And the third one, is Maps of Meaning. They're the same book. They're just like, they're trying to solve the same problem from three different directions. They're all attempts to address the same problem. And so Symbols of Transformation was a book that Jung wrote about the fantasies of a schizophrenic American woman. And he was trying to relate her fantasies to these old mythological ideas. And Jung's idea, essentially, and this is an idea that was shared by people like Piaget, so we're not going to say that Jung or Freud just pulled this idea out of the air, was that the birthplace of mythology and literature, for that matter, was the dream. That they share structural, that they share what? Mode of information presentation. And it's a relatively radical hypothesis, but given that they both represent Dreams and mythological representations share an essentially narrative structure, and they're literary-like, you know, I mean, it's not so unreasonable to notice that a dream at night is like the movie that you play in your head. And it's not unreasonable to note as well that the dreams that you have at night bear a relationship to the daydreams that you have during the day. It's a form of cognition. It seems like an involuntary form of cognition, though, and that's a very strange thing. So Jung thought about the dream as nature speaking of its own accord, roughly speaking. And so his idea was, well, when you sleep, you dream, but the dream happens to you. It's not something that you create the way that, and you don't even think about creating it. Because I might say, well, what are you thinking about? And you'll say, I'm thinking about whatever it is. And you'll take credit in some sense for thinking that because it seems like a voluntary activity. But what happens at night is that you think, but you think involuntarily. And so what Jung would say is that means that something is thinking in you. And that's a perfectly reasonable way of looking at it. And this is one of the things that's uncanny about the psychoanalysts, is they were willing to take their observations to their logical conclusion. There are things that think in you. What are those things? And what are they thinking? And why are they thinking it? Now, if you do dream analysis, and this is a tricky thing, because who's to say if your damn analysis is correct, right? It's very difficult to understand that. If you do dream analysis with someone, you generally have them lay out their dream. And then you ask them when they're going through their dream a second time. They lay out their dream and you can kind of get a picture of it. And then they lay out their dream a second time. And as they go through it, every time they mention a detail or a character, you ask them what that reminds them of. And the hypothesis is that the dream is presenting an image or an idea that's associated with a network of ideas, and that if you can expand on the network of ideas as you go through the dream, you can elaborate on the dream, you can expand it upwards, and you can start to see what it might be attempting to put forward. Now, Freud's idea was that the dream knew what it was doing, but that its content was being suppressed and oppressed by an internal censor. So the dream had to be sneaky about what it was saying because it was going to deliver a message that the person didn't want to hear. And that was tied up with his idea of repression. But that's not Jung's idea. See, Jung's idea was different. He said, no, the dream is trying to tell you what it's trying to tell you as clear as it can. That's just the best it can do. And so you could think of the dream, and this is, I believe, the right way to think about it. The dream is the birthplace of thought, the same way that artists are the birthplace of culture. It's exactly the same process. It's that your mind is groping outward to try to comprehend what it has not yet comprehended. And it does that first by trying to map it onto image. And it's doing that in the dream, and it's somewhat incoherent, and let's stick with incoherent, because it's not yet a full-fledged thought. It's the birthplace of thought. It's a fantasy about what might be. And then if you can grip the fantasy and share it with other people, then maybe they can elaborate upon it and bring it into being with more clarity than it would be if it merely existed as the precursor of a thought in your imagination.